This is a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. State House program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.
Well, thank you so much for taking time to be with me today. And I wanted to cover a few things from the budget address that we had this week. After the budget address was completed, we have dropped 26 different pieces of legislation to coincide with those policies that I discussed and unveiled to the legislature and the people for consideration. I wanted to cover just two of those with you and some details on those because I think they're very important for the state of South Dakota. One of them was in regards to Palisades State Park. Palisades State Park is in the southeastern corner of the state. It right now encompasses 167 acres. Recently, the Parks and Wildlife Foundation was able to purchase another 257 acres that adjoins that original 167 acres and really will make it a much better opportunity for the people of the state to enjoy the outdoors. In my budget, I proposed $500,000 that would be presented as a challenge grant that would be matched with other dollars in order to put infrastructure into those 257 acres as soon as possible. And the reason that I identified that was because Palisades State Park today, at that size that it is, receives about 90,000 visitors a year. It's a very busy park, heavily utilized. There's very little infrastructure there. There's about 2 miles of hiking trails today, no camping sites, and we recognize that we have heavy demand in the southeastern part of the state and would like to get more camping sites, like to get more trails put into place, and people are excited to start using that park and using the expanded site of it as well. So that was some more details to that package, and we're hoping that that can get funded so we can match it with private and outside dollars to get that infrastructure done. The second portion I just wanted to cover with you quickly was $1.8 million partnering with the REPI program. And the REPI program is the Readiness and Environmental Protection Integration Program. And this has to do with Ellsworth Air Force Base, which is critically important to South Dakota and to our nation's security. We have land surrounding the base that we would like to partner with federal dollars in order to deal with encroachment. Sometimes there are incompatible uses to land that is surrounding the base, that if we have the opportunity with willing sellers to purchase some of that land and be able to take it that factor out, it makes the base more viable into the future. And certainly with the new mission that is coming with the B-21 bombers, it's critically important that we do all the work that we can to secure the base, deal with the encroachment issue, and make sure that we're utilizing those federal funds as well to make the base as BRAC-proof as possible. Not only are missions critically important to the future of Ellsworth, but also doing our work to make sure that the base has all of the elements that are necessary to keep it viable for the long term is incredibly important. So that $1.8 million will match federal dollars that will allow us to deal with some of those encroachment issues. And with that, I'll open it up to any questions that you may have on other specifics. Yeah.
With the nursing home crisis going on, how much can that or can contribute to out-of-state owners, in-state owners, and local community owners? Local community being, even during this crisis, Philip Nursing Home is expanding.
So I haven't really done that analysis to know the true impact of what ownership does. I do know that in my conversations I've had with nursing homes and their different CEOs and managers, is that it does make a difference how many facilities that they have in their scope. For instance, one of the individuals I met with this week and talked to before I released my budget address was saying he had six different facilities. Two of them were losing money. The other four were supporting keeping those two open. So if they do have an opportunity to have more than one facility and one is not doing as well, that may help them keep it viable for a short period of time, but not necessarily a long-term solution. Our nursing homes are facing challenges. And I think that's critically important that we take a realistic look at what we can do. That's why you saw me put forward a provider rate increase that equaled 5% for them so that we can meet their costs. That gets them to almost 100%. I believe 99.5 or 100% of their costs that they report to us on Medicaid patients that they're taking care of. And then beyond that, why I put forward the $5 million in innovation grants, which that $5 million in innovation grants will allow them to develop new methods of care. We have big demand from folks in the state and from families that want to keep their families home longer with them. If there's a way we can provide respite care and allow them to contract with nurses or caregivers to come into the home and be reimbursed, that would be very helpful. If we can find ways to provide more skills and more coverage in an assisted living, so people can stay in assisted living longer, that would be something that families would find very desirable. So those innovation grants will be to push new challenges to the table and have these providers that deliver care every day to a population in our state to bring those new ideas to the table so that we can be innovative as we still care for those who need the help.
Governor, could you give us an update on the South Dakota National Guard helo and crew that was deployed to the southern border?
We have been getting regular updates from the Adjutant General. They're doing well. Normal operations have been ongoing, and we will hear more detail in the coming week is when we'll get more summaries through the National Guard. But from what I understand, everything is progressing normally.
And as a follow-up to that today, President Trump said that he is looking at declaring an emergency both to send more troops to the southern border as well as address the federal government shutdown. That would require, as I understand, a consultation with governors across the United States and obvious planning ahead of time. Have you had those conversations, and what are you hearing on that subject?
I have not had those conversations with the White House or the administration. I'm not certain if the Adjutant General has, but I will follow up with him. But I'm sure that if that is an action that the White House is taking, that there will be some conversations ongoing.
And are you prepared to send more troops?
We'll evaluate that at that time.
On the Ellsworth issue, mm-hmm. can you talk more about encroachment and kind of how buying mm-hmm. that land would help? Just a little more information.
Ellsworth, as you know, sits east of Rapid City, also close to the town of Box Elder, and has people and ranches and small acreages surrounding the base. For years, the Ellsworth Development Authority and Task Force have been working to secure different land around the base for a safety zone. So when they have operations, when flights are taking off and B-1s are landing and coming in, and for crash zones, that they have a space around the base that is deemed a safety area that that we would have no threat to life or limb if something were to happen within that space. That's normal operations for any air base in the United States, and it is something that we took very seriously because it was something the Air Force addressed to us years ago when there was discussion about BRAC and evaluation of bases to see what their long-term prospects are for getting new missions. So this is something that we've been focused on as a state, is making sure that we're working with Ellsworth and the Development Authority and the task force to make sure that we're preparing the base best for the future. It makes us more viable for new missions and for long-term commitments on our national security front if we do this work to prevent encroachment, to secure land mass around the base and make sure that we're addressing any kind of safety issues that could arise.
Just one follow-up. Mm-hmm. In terms of the I don't know how you would measure it, but the $1.8 million, mm-hmm. is there like a percentage that gets us to in terms of anything, you know, any measurement?
Well, I think it was 1 or 2 years ago, there was a match as well from the state to federal funds to do this exact same operation. I'm not certain over time how much has been spent to deal with the encroachment issue, but I could follow up with you and get you that detail if that's the answer to what you're asking.
Governor Don Wick, Red River Farm Network. Certainly with the economic challenges in agriculture right now, is there some things that can be done at the state level to support farmers and ranchers from South Dakota?
Well, we have one of the highest bases in the nation, so I'm always looking for solutions to transportation costs. We have to get our commodities to market, and making sure that we're looking at how we move those commodities out of our state is critically important. Also looking at value-added projects. If we can put in more ethanol plants, new soybean processing plants, if we can add value to products and to livestock production, then that's incredibly important that we do that processing close to home so we can save transportation costs as we move that finished product out of the state as well. And then I'm continuing to advocate for more trade agreements to be completed so we can open up new markets. That's what our farmers really want. They want the ability to sell to the world. That's what they do best, is they feed the world. And so using my opportunity as governor and my knowledge from my years spent overseeing trade at the federal level gives me a unique position and insight into how trade agreements get done. And my relationship that I've developed with the U.S. Trade Ambassador, we have a constant stream of information going back and forth to see if we can get these trade agreements summarized and finalized and get those markets open back up.
Thank you. James. Your bill on the informed consent form that abortion providers passed today out of committee, can you talk about why that was a bill that you introduced and why it's important to you?
Well, abortion providers in the state have, for the last couple of years, been blurring the lines on what the statute requires for informed consent to get an abortion in the state of South Dakota. So this form in this bill will require them to fill out a state-issued form that proves that they have adequately informed that individual of the facts that abortion provider is required to do before they get an abortion and report it back to the state. So it just clarifies their requirements, gives them a form that they will need to fill out and submit to us that they have done their due diligence before performing an abortion.
I have just one.
Sure.
You've had a little more than 2 weeks on the job here as governor, probably haven't caught your breath, but could you give me an idea of what it's like to transition from Congress to the mm-hmm. governor's office and what that contrast or comparison might be now that you've had 30 seconds to think about it?
You know, we actually were talking about this morning, that it's actually been wonderful. I am so blessed to be in this position and incredibly humbled as well. So I'm thrilled that I'm in the state full time, that I'm here working on policies that are important to people close to home, but yet are going to have an impact nationwide as well. And I'm not spending half my time on airplanes going back and forth between here and Washington, D.C. And that in itself can be life changing. Anything else?
During the newspaper press conference, gosh, was that yesterday?
Yeah, it was.
there was some talk about your administration talking with local law enforcement about concerns over, you know, man camps and what might be mm-hmm. happening with the Keystone XL pipeline. I was wondering, I know there had been concerns during the DAPL stuff about the company that was providing intel. Mm-hmm. Do you know who might be providing intel at this point in terms of what's going on the ground level?
No, we don't. We're having some conversations on that, but nothing's been finalized. So when we do get that, we'll make sure that we follow up with all of you. Yeah, go ahead, James.
Just wanted to ask, the Senate has passed their permitless concealed carry bill. Mm. The House says they're going to just take up that bill. I know you convened a meeting of stakeholders. Mm-hmm. Would you offer any warning to lawmakers or to come to the table to work with law enforcement or anything, or will you just evaluate their bill?
you know, that is the one thing that we committed to, is bringing everybody to the table and having this conversation. And so we have been talking with legislators about their priorities. We have been talking to law enforcement about their concerns as well. And this is the legislative process. They'll continue to have debates. They'll go through committee. And they will send to me a bill that we'll make a decision on. I've long said that I support the concept of constitutional carry, but it will make a difference what the language says. So I know that as the House continues to move that bill across, it could change, and we'll take a look at it when it gets to me.
Governor, part of what you mentioned in your budget speech was some money to help first responder agencies upgrade their radio systems across the state. I was involved in emergency management for a very brief time, and that was a concern that a lot of the fire departments had, the small town fire departments, trying to update all their radios so there can be interoperability between all the agencies in the state. Where did those conversations come from, and why is that something that you included to highlight in your budget address?
I've been hearing about this concern for the last couple of years from local law enforcement, that there was going to be a big cost for the upgrade that needed to happen at the state level. It's a 9.2 million dollar cost for the state's responsibility of upgrading our state radio system, and it's incredibly important that it operates because it is the link that connects all different levels of enforcement and public safety activities that happen for the state of South Dakota. So being ready and prepared for that upgrade is very important. It's also, as you noted, important that the counties are prepared, because they will have expenses as well. They will have radios and equipment that they'll need to purchase to work on that state system when it is installed and ready to go. So I am proposing in my budget that we set aside half of the dollars that will be required to upgrade the system, because we have the revenue this year. And when you know there's a big purchase looming, it's wise to put away those dollars and plan for that in the future. We don't want to risk our public safety and ability to respond to anything that could happen, especially with items such as the Keystone Pipeline coming through the state. And so I'm planning for that and setting aside revenue so that we're ready in 2023 when that upgrade needs to happen, that it is, the resources are there, we're able to install it and get it going. But I would encourage counties to know that the state is serious about the upgrade and that they should be as well. Nothing? Okay. Thank you, everybody. Appreciate it. Have a wonderful weekend.
Wonderful weekend.
State House program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.